Welcome to the Old Bob Show. Located in beautiful Westby amidst the scenic ridges and coulees of western Wisconsin. And now here's your program host, Bob Burl, along with his special guests.
Hello everybody and welcome to another edition of the Old Bob Show. Unfortunately, Bob couldn't be with us today and this is Dan Kapanke pinch hitting for Bob. But we have a very good, informative program for you today. We have a special guest, Jeanene Thicke-Sanders, and we're going to be talking about Children's Vision International. Welcome, Jeanene, and tell us a little bit about Children's Vision International and how you got started and involved with this.
Well, good morning. Thank you so much. Children's Vision is a nonprofit international organization that helps the homeless and the needy. It was started back in 1993. And when we founded Children's Vision, it was because I had went to Colombia at the age of 23, and a few years later, I found a baby living in a box. She was literally living in the trash. And so I called my family, who is from Bangor, Wisconsin, and the Thicke family, and I let them know that I had found a baby and I wanted to do something. I didn't know what something was. I just knew that I found a baby and I really wanted to help. And my mom and dad said, Jeanene, do whatever it takes. So we started a program called Children's Vision International, founded by myself and my family and some friends. And we began to take in children one by one by one. And that's 21 years ago. And today we're caring for 200 kids.
So you went to Columbia at age 23. Why did you go to Columbia?
Well, I had graduated from Christ for the Nations in Dallas, Texas. And then when I had graduated, I started serving on the mission field and I went to Israel and Mexico and Argentina, but I never found that it was my place. And I came back home and I told my parents that I'd like to do something. And I prayed and I heard Colombia. And I went. And it was crazy and I was young and I was probably really dumb. And when I got there, I fell in love with it because of the Andes Mountains and because of the Spanish and because of the culture, and I ended up staying.
So when you got there and you found that baby in the box, what did you do then?
Cried. I went home to the place that I was staying that night, and it was a small apartment, and I looked around and I seen the picture of my family, and I seen the bed that I slept in, and I seen what I had. And she had nothing. And I wondered why I would be born in Wisconsin in a small town of Bangor and how she could be born in the trash in a city of 10 million and have nobody help her. And so when I called my parents, I said, I don't know what to do. I don't know anything about saving babies. I don't know anything about taking a baby in, but I know I have to do something. So we started Children's Vision. It took us a year to do the legal papers and the nonprofit and everything else, and then raising funds for a children's home that was a someday. Someday we're going to help children, and someday we're going to help this baby, and someday. And it's hard to sell a someday. And we bought a house, and it's called the Genesis House, and it was a dump. It was a fixer-upper that should have been a tear-downer. And we started renovating it. And every time we got a bedroom ready, babies and families started showing up at Children's Vision. And a mom would come, and one of our first babies was a mom. She had lost an arm in a street fight. And she was living on the streets and selling herself. And she came and she was holding a three-month-old baby and she said, now what is your name? And I said, my name is Jeanene. And she said, Jeanene, this is your new son, Brian. And she popped her son with her other arm into my arms and he was 3 months old. He was just a little tiny baby. She had drunk a lot of alcohol. He was very sick. And we began to raise him. And right now he's 18 years old. Serving in the police force, a wonderful young man, and very grateful to have had a home at Children's Vision. And then from there, I took in the next baby. It was a mom who was 19, dying with AIDS, and her daughter was 3 months old. She was a crack baby. She would shake so hard. She was sick so hard because of all the drugs that her parents had used. And we were able to rescue her. And a few short years later, she passed away in a gang fight on the streets. Mm. So when we began to take the children in, first you start becoming their home, but then you start becoming their family. And then you become everything as you begin to provide all of their needs, for their physical needs and their mental needs and their emotional needs. And then it just goes on from there. So from a box, we became a home and a foundation and a school and a medical unit and everything. And it's just continued on.
So do you know what happened to that first baby that you found in the box?
Absolutely.
Tell the audience.
All righty. When I began to look at her, she was 3 months old. And as I looked at her little fingers, she had been bitten by rats. And we began to take her to the hospital. She had to have injections in her little tummy. And we were able to rescue her. She grew up at Children's Vision. She's now graduated from high school. She's bilingual. She's my neighbor. She lives next door to us. She's moved off site, and she's doing wonderfully, and her name is Gisela.
That's a wonderful, wonderful story. Tell us, Jeanene, how you got started, initially, and how you got funding to get where you are today, and then we're going to get into where you are today and what you're doing today.
All righty. When we began and we bought the Genesis house, people laughed at me, and it was kind of like Noah's Ark, and it was just an old, ugly, ugly house, and there was rats everywhere, and there was garbage everywhere, and so the beginning stages, I mean, was dump trucks and shovels and picks and getting the garbage out so that one day that could become a home. And then as we began to clean, teams started to come in, and our first team, all they did the whole time was moved 40 dump loads of garbage out of our backyard. So they were so mad at us because they said, you know, why work so hard to do something that is nobody's ever going to know we took this garbage out of here. But yet that was the beginning of saving hundreds of little children's lives. Then as time went on, we had a house full of kids, and we had no washers, no dryers, no disposable diapers. We had our very first kitchen. It was just the beginning stages of everything that you're doing. And you would have to be almost crazy to even start it because you're starting with nothing. I mean, absolutely nothing. And then one person would believe in you and they'd give you a pair of shoes. And the next person would believe in you and they'd give you, you know, your first bottles and your first bed. And that's how we began, with nothing. In 1999, we started our second children's home, because we had a waiting list of children wanting to be able to live with us. And then we filled that one. And then in 2005, we started a third children's home, and we filled that. And right now we have another waiting list of children needing to have a home. And we're about to start our fourth home. And in the middle of all of that, we also started a school. And our school is called Beginning of Wisdom School. And when we take a child in, we provide everything completely free of charge. We provide everything free of charge to that child. And so our programs have developed and grown, but the vision and the dream from day one, back in 1993, was to have 5 homes, a school, and a medical unit. And today, we're 21 years later, and we're starting our fourth home. We have the school, we have the medical unit, and we're helping thousands of people.
That is an awesome story, just because you went to Columbia and found
a baby in a box.
And so how are you helping in other areas besides Columbia?
In Bangor, Wisconsin, we have our headquarters. And from there, we send help out everywhere. If there's a local need, we help the community locally. If there's a natural disaster, we want to be able to help and provide supplies. We've got community service in Bangor that you can come and help stateside. And anyone who's going anywhere will help you. So if you're going on a mission trip and you're going to Mexico or Africa or Indonesia and you need some supplies, people come to Children's Vision. We donate to them so that they can help others. We can't get there, but you can. So that's how we like to help.
That is tremendous. How are you doing for funding and how are you raising money to help these kids, mm-hmm. and how's that going?
this month that I'm home, we're doing fundraisers the whole time that I'm here. We serve 600 meals a day. So if you times that, in a year, that's 220,000 meals at our house at Children's Vision. We, you know, provide everything for these kids, and adding on another home means we have more expenses. And we are always in need of funds. I mean, that's just a never abundance at our home. And we won't deny a child help because we don't have the money. I've always believed that you just help and help again, no matter what it's going to take.
People, again, in this area and throughout the world are so giving and want to help. Mm-hmm. There's so many people that want to help. So, again, tell the audience here and tell us how we can help you in Bangor, Wisconsin.
One of the things that you can do is you can donate time. You can come and serve at our headquarters by helping pack the donations and the supplies that are coming in. But the number one thing that we have are financial needs. We need money to buy food. We need money for lights and water. We need money for the school uniforms. We need money to be able to go do our grocery shopping. We use 2,400 eggs a month. And when I do grocery shopping, I have to have a whole day. So I leave early in the morning and I shop all day and I come home and we pack our bus. It's a 33 passenger bus. And you're bringing, you know, it's not a little SUV. We have a 33 passenger SUV to come home and bring all the supplies in. And it all takes funds. And we have the heart to reach children. We have children on a waiting list. We have the ability to do it. And we need more resources to be able to do what we do.
Do you have a website?
We
how
do.
Can people get a hold of you?
We're a little bit obsolete because I help so many kids. But our website is childrensvision.org. And there's a PayPal account on there if anybody would like to give through there. If you want to send a gift to Children's Vision, you can do that through P.O. Box 380, Bangor, Wisconsin.
That is awesome. We have a few minutes here. Can you tell us a few stories about not only in Columbia but throughout the world how you've helped people, and do you have a specific story or two to say?
Sure. I know more stories about Columbia because that's where I've spent the past 26 years. We got a knock on our door, and it was a little boy, and he was crying, and he said, "I've lived my whole life on the streets, and I don't want my brothers to do the same." And then he passed me a set of twins. They were 18 months old, and he said, "These are my brothers, and I'd really like you to help." As I began to put my hand on their head and just welcome them to our home, I found huge lumps where they had been beaten and misabused. The two little boys had their own language, and because they were twins, they didn't talk, they had their own language, and eventually they started to grow and to grow up, and the two boys have now graduated from our high school. They're going on to college, and they're going to study journalism in Uruguay.
Wow.
And it's another set of twins that we've helped. We've had four sets of twins at our home that we've rescued.
How are you documenting all this? Because I'm thinking that someday you should write a book.
A lot of people have said that we should write a book. I document every case, actually, with real footage. And I go in and I show where the kids have come from, where we've brought them to, how their lives have been changed. And it's more than just words. It's actual footage of how we've transformed the lives of all of these children.
How has it been in Columbia dealing with the government?
At the beginning, it was very hard. It was very, very, very hard. They didn't trust me. Here's a white girl from North America. What are my reasons for doing what I do? Why Columbia? Why now? And stay tuned because I'll be telling you all about that. When Children's Vision began, there was a lot of things that were difficult. First, establishing who you were and what you wanted to do and create this vision of what you could do when you really weren't even sure. There was a lot of hoops to jump through. There was a lot of permits. There was a lot of government things that you had to work through. And at the beginning, it was very, 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 very difficult. I wasn't trusted. I was an American in a third world country, war-torn, helping children. Why was I there? What was my second agenda? What was I doing? And it took us a long time to get all of our permits and all of our approvals in line. At one point, one man had accused me of doing illegal things, and it was taken as truth. And so the police showed up at my house, and they were going to haul me to prison. Eventually, they found out that he lied and that I was just there to help kids. Through the years, we've been able to get our children's homes approvals and our educational approvals and our international approvals. And today, we have been honored to have the approval through the presidency to import the donations that we bring into the country. And so what you know, had been for evil, God turned for good. And now we bring in the containers, fully approved through the president of Colombia, to bring them in tax-free and to be able to serve the people. And that's how we're able to reach so many, not only with the gospel, but also with the humanitarian aid supplies.
That's just tremendous. God bless you for what you're doing.
Thank you.
Let's talk a little bit about Colombia. You know, when we mention Colombia, some of us might think, well, that's a poor country, a third world country. Tell us what it's like down there.
It's nothing like you see on TV. Colombia is beautiful. We're surrounded by the Andes Mountains. It has beautiful people. We have roses and flowers and emeralds and coffee and bananas and all kinds of things. And we also are a war-torn country. We have victims of families that are displaced due to violence. We have families that are still losing their homes because of rebel forces. And those are the families that we also help. We take in children and families that have lost everything. The rebels come in, they're on their farm one day, and they come in with machine guns and all of these different things, and they say, you have to give us your property or you die. And the people have to leave with everything that they have just in their hands and on their backs. There's no homes for them, there's no food, there's no education. So when they leave, they're leaving everything. And we get knocks on our door, and they'll be standing there saying, please, could you help us? My children are going to sleep under the bridge tonight. Would you please help us? And we've raised many, many, many of those children. And in fact, I was just explaining that one of the little boys we had taken in was 12 years old, and he can very vividly tell you the stories about when the machine guns came to his farm and how they threatened all of his family, and several people were actually murdered. And they fled for their lives. And we took him in at age 12. And that's an older age for me, and there's a lot of risk involved in an age like that. And he promised me if we just gave him the opportunity, he would be my best student. He wasn't in school, and I was worried that we would push him too hard, that we would break his spirit, because he had to learn to read, to write. He had to learn to achieve on his own. And he promised that he would do it, and he became our number one student at our school. He learned to read, he learned to write, he excelled. He was awarded a one-year scholarship to study at Cooley Region Christian School in Winston-Salem. He came, he was given awards at the end of the school year, and we then applied for a scholarship at Oral Roberts University, and they've never given a full scholarship. They've given partial, and our son was given a full scholarship at Oral Roberts University, a complete miracle, and it was merit-based.
What a tremendous story. Tell us a little bit about the school system in Colombia.
We have mega schools in Bogota. We're in a city of almost 10 million people. There's a lot of schools that are very large. There's a lot of private schools. We're a private Christian school. But there's also a lot of children that do not go to school, because you have to provide for your books, you have to provide for your meals, you have to provide for your uniforms. And most parents that hardly have any income whatsoever can't afford it. So therefore, their children don't go to school. They never have an education. We go and we do a case study for the children that apply to our school, and we choose the neediest of all. We choose that child that will never go to school. We choose a child that's never going to be able to have that education, and then we provide free education for them. And it's a beautiful cycle.
Wow, again, what a beautiful story that is. Let's talk a little bit about some of the areas in which you work. You mentioned medical care, mm-hmm. evangelism, humanitarian aid, education, and also hunger relief. Tell us how you do that. I mean, you're one person, mother, how do you do that?
We have volunteers. We do a medical mission once a year, and we have areas that contact us and say, would you please come? And in this past June, we just did a medical mission, and we attended 5,000 people in 5 days. And we had doctors from the United States, from England, where my husband is from, and also from Colombia. And so we go in with a walking MASH unit, and we organize it. Children's Vision organizes. Our children are the translators to the doctors, and now some of our children are becoming medical professionals because they've served on the medical mission team. And then we also have the education, so we provide all of the education for the children. We also provide humanitarian aid. And we go into villages and communities, we give out groceries, we provide the medical care, we assist the babies that are so sick, and we continue to work with those communities, and eventually, once we build up the trust, then they study in our school. And so we break the cycle of poverty through education, through prayer, through all of our help and hope, and make a difference one life at a time.
That is, again, just a great, great story. What about, you talked about medical care evangelism?
Mm-hmm. We go and we have a drama team and a worship team, and our kids go to the parks, they work in the churches, and they're sharing the gospel with others. And this year we gave out 4,500 track packs, and many people gave their hearts to the Lord.
Jeepers. Education, we talked about a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Preschool through high school and also technical classes.
The people that go down there to help, are they all volunteering, or is their expenses in going, flying down there, how is that taken care of?
Everyone pays all of their own expenses. We have a guest house, and we charge $20 a day to be able to stay there, and we provide your meals and your housing while you're there, and then you serve and work hard, and we hope you give a donation while you're there.
Speaking of that, let's give them the website. Let's give our audience the website again and talk a little bit about how we in Western Wisconsin can help you.
Our website is childrensvision.org, childrensvision.org, and donations can be sent to P.O. Box 380, Bangor, Wisconsin, 54614.
Very, very good. We have a few minutes left. Do you have any other stories? You had some great stories earlier. Do you have another one or two that you could tell the audience here about a success story of what you did?
We have another young girl that's studying at Cooley Region right now in Winston-Salem, and she was another one of our twins, and her mom brought her at 18 months old, and we have raised her and her twin brother, and when the mom brought her to us, the mom never came back, and we raised her, and she's now 18, and she loves the Lord with her whole heart, and she's here studying in the States, and she wants to make a difference in someone else's life. And that's what you do, one life at a time.
Very, very good. You know, someplace in the Bible it says that we're supposed to use the talents that we're given to help others. Mm-hmm. And what a great story you are in Children's Vision International. Thank you, Jeanene, for being here today and talking about what you do.
Thank you.
You've been watching The Old Bob Show on your community channel. Check your guide for other Old Bob programming and have a good day. Thank you.